Double bubble boil in trouble. Is Friday's quad witching going to burst GME's bubble? But first, let me address a few things. First, I would love to thank you for letting me live rent-free in your heads. Second, people think I'm short GME for some reason. I'm not. At least not yet right now. But, you know, and for the people who think I'm missing out, I'm not. I think it's funny, but I'm not really going to put my money towards this. I have no horse in this race whatsoever. And also, to that one person that tried to sneakily be a little controversial, please have some balls. Don't delete your messages. And no, I'm not Japanese. So based on previous video analytics, I can tell that a lot of people like to see and want my opinions on how to screw up these hedge funds because I seem to know a lot and all that sort of stuff. One thing is that, no, I'm not a pro and expert on this thing. But the second thing is, if you guys really want to screw up the hedge funds, the easiest way for you guys to do it is to hit that like button, leave a comment, and especially if you hit that big red subscribe button, I hear that that screws over the hedge funds quite well. It's very effective. Try it now. Real talk really quickly, though. If you guys made money on GME, I'm happy for you. I'm legit happy for you. But I also want you guys to exercise some form of logic and reasoning for this, because right now what's happening with GME is total mania. A lot of people aren't investing logically and sound, and I know it sounds boomerish to do that, but the problem is that GME is not doing anything currently. The CEO for AMC, he refinanced his debt, so he got a lot of that debt off his books, and he gave it to his loan the people who loaned him the money, who actually made more from getting the shares in exchange for that debt that they had, instead of actually having to wait for it to the bonds to mature. They got shares instead, and they sold it at market at a very good price, so they made a lot more and a lot faster, so they're very happy. He also did a share offering again as well, which raised capital for AMC that they desperately needed. None of this is what GME is doing. GME is doing absolutely nothing at this point, as far as I can tell, other than bringing on some e-commerce guy. But there's a lot of competition in the e-commerce space, if you guys haven't really noticed. Like, you got Amazon, you got eBay, you got Best Buy, like I previously mentioned. Like, any one of these retailers, well, eBay is not really much of a retailer, but any of the other retailers that you guys can think of, like Target, et cetera, you guys have a lot in the States, by the way. All these guys are all competitors for GameStop, who's basically late to the party. Now, I will talk about what's possibly going on inside a lot of hedge funds' minds right now, or essentially a lot of the investment firms, and why GME is kind of taking off right now. I'll explain that a lot later, but first, let's hit the data first. All right, so for those who stayed to the technical portion of the previous video, thank you. If you guys also remember, this is shortsqueeze.com, the site that I was using previously for, a lot of people that were using for this to gauge short interest. As you can see, it's at 26.06%, or 26%, I'm just going to round it off there, a change at 14%. So this was previously 40% when I last talked about it. Now, if you guys also remember me last talking about this as well, is that this is about 2 weeks delayed. And if we look at the calendar, we'll see that they had to settle this on the 26th. So all of their trades had to be done by the 26th, and they don't have to report what they finished on until, I believe, about the 2nd. Yeah, about the March 2nd. So right around there. And then they don't disseminate this information until after market on the 9th. So this is about like 2 weeks worth of data that is, not 2 weeks worth, but you're behind about 2 weeks worth. And if we look at the chart and price and everything, we'll see that around the 26th is when they settled, and then a couple days afterwards, that's when they reported. And then we end up here after, all the short interest got disseminated and everybody got their updated info that, you know, they levied off some of the shorts. Now, here's the thing, though. A lot of people tried to rationalize this and try to draw a story. The story that they draw so far is that the DTCC had to raise their margin requirements to say to continue being solvent and have liquidity for like GME and stuff like that. So because they raised that margin requirements, a lot of these hedge funds didn't have the money to cover it, so they had to actually cover some of their shorts, and that's what caused the rise and so forth and so forth. Honestly, I don't think that that's wrong. But I also think that it's kind of surreal to think that, you know, GME could go to 1,000. Whether that happens or not is anybody's guess. But my guess right now is I think that the stimulus is going to give it a further boost. But there's a little bit more nuance to that than you think. And I'll explain that a little bit later. In this portion, I want you guys to kind of come back down to earth for a second here, right? because everybody has this whole sentiment, especially the more fanatical ones have this whole sentiment that, you know, GME is going to go to the moon, and also my other stock and stuff like that. And, you know, my opinion is obviously that people are very unfocused on GME. That's why we're not seeing such drastic movement, but that's besides the point. Now, I wanted to present a couple questions to you first. First is, what happens when you guys run out of government money to throw out this thing? Second, the institutions that have actually jumped in and ridden the train along with you guys on GME to the upside, they have likely the same mentality that I do, in the sense that, you know, I'm just here to make money. And since GME is going up, I mean, I'm not going to fight the trend on the downside. I'm going to go with the trend on the upside. They have to take profit at some point. And they're not taking small bits of profit. They're taking large amounts out of the stock. And what would happen after they do that? And, you know, to answer your first question is that there gets to a point. Like, obviously, if we thought of this as like something that kind of ebbs and flows on a scale or something like that, right? If we put this on a scale, and right now you guys are the buyers, so you guys are basically winning. So you guys are the heaviest over here. Here's the sellers, right? So the government money comes in, so you add a couple more stones, so the scale goes like that. Now, if there's no more new stones coming on here, and these guys haven't added their new stones on there as well, which they have a lot more stones that they're not like showing to you guys, they just have to start putting on just a little bit. And those guys who added the stones on the buy side, especially the institutional ones, they have to protect their clients' profits, and they also have to protect their money as well. So they're going to start taking money off the table, in other words, taking stones off of this side, which then gives these guys more leverage. And then once they have a little bit more, they're going to start adding a little bit more and a little bit more. They're going to start taking a little bit more away. You guys will still be holding this as retailers, but not to the amount that some of the institutional side is holding. And they can't get all in one go. There's not enough liquidity there. They have to do this like over time, especially since if these institutions smell blood in the water, they're going to pounce on that. They're going to keep putting on the pressure until these guys get frantic and they start like essentially massively selling out of the market. As well, some of these funds that have jumped in on the train to go to the upside and stuff like that, they have a limitation on how much and how long they can have this thing. So that's not another added reason, because they have to sometimes maintain a certain balance within a portfolio. They might be having to do with the portfolio's investment philosophy, and most importantly, it has to do something with risk. If they can't essentially sell this to their clients, and or this is not what their clients signed up for, they're going to get in a lot of trouble, especially a lot of regulator trouble, because they actually are supposed to be, you know, professionals. But yeah, the risk for them might not be worth the hold. Now, if I was to put on my evil, douchey banker portrayal, now, if it were me, as an institution guy, I would wait for the stimulus to be put out to everybody's account, and then I would wait a week after that, because I want to ensure that everybody is plugged into their trading account, however much their stimulus is and everything. Some deposits are instant, but some have a long carry time, up to a week. I'm looking at you, Interactive Brokers. Phase two, I would wait for people to lose interest in the next maybe 2 to 6 weeks or so. And that's actually very synonymous with the reopen / travel time, because people want to go be in a sunny beach somewhere or something like that, travel around, do all that sort of stuff, right? They're going to be distracted. Phase three, after you guys go on vacation, enjoy the sun, soak it up a little bit, live it up, thinking you're going to be a millionaire when you come home on GME, then I strike you when you're at your weakest and when you're not paying attention. Jokes aside, though, I want to reinforce about 3.5 things and kind of give you guys some a little bit of perspective just to wrap this up. But first one is, if you guys have legitimately made money off this thing, I am happy for you. Like, I am legitimately happy for you. I've had a long career where I've risen and fallen multiple times, and I was able to pick myself back up. I'm hoping that this gives you enough buffer to pick yourself back up and get your life back going again. Second one is, I want to warn you guys about something called price discovery. And it's just something that naturally occurs in the market and stuff like that. But what it means is that, like, if you guys, for some weird scenario, buy up all the available shares that are floating in the current market and they don't do a dilution or anything like that, we might go into what's called price discovery mode, because especially if no one's taking any new short side positions, but we might go into price discovery mode. And what that is that, I'm not going to overcomplicate this, is that people see price go like this, right? Like, just in a very tight range. They'll call it congestion, they'll call it whatever technical crap, seek and destroy, whatever that sort of crap, right? What that usually means is that the market makers who finally have come back are looking for pockets of liquidity, because their whole game, and they do a lot, by the way, their whole game is to find and execute orders, because that's how they make money. It's one way, anyways, but that's how they make money. So until they actually hit a pocket of liquidity and actually fill that order, they're going to keep going up and down and sweeping up and down the prices, which will create higher volatility. Again, it's a good thing and a bad thing. It could happen in favor or out of favor for you. Just be aware of that. The third thing is that there's a little silver lining that not a lot of people really know about, and it's having to do with this thing I read about 2 weeks ago, where it says that the DTCC has released a 2-year industry roadmap for shortening the settlement cycle, and early indications are implying that there's a T+1 instead of the standard T+2. What this means is that your funds are going to be settled a lot faster, and for those of you guys in the States that are complaining about the Dodd-Frank Act and the pattern day trade rule, this means that you'll be able to pattern day trade a little bit faster without actually having the PDT violations. So it's kind of a win, but not a huge win. The half point is kind of the most important one of all. If you take nothing else away from this video, I want you guys to do this, because this is actually the most important thing you guys can do, and that is to hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, leave a comment, and just remember, just because you're a day trader doesn't mean you have to trade every single day.